The second Spider-Man No Way Home trailer is here, and honestly, I thought that was a pretty bad trailer.
I know a couple of magic words myself, starting with the word please.
Please, Scooby-Doo this crap.
Nothing Uncharted levels of bad, but I definitely wasn't vibing with the nostalgia-baiting PowerPoint presentation. I didn't get a feel of the story that was in any way engaging, nor a reason to be for all of these extra Spider-Man villains coming together, other than to make some cheddar cheese. I'm still quite hyped for the movie, and I do believe it was just a badly cut trailer, but it doesn't help my hype for the movie. I actually wish we'd just stuck with the first trailer.
Hello, Peter.
There's only 4 weeks left to go. Why not? It's fine. We know enough. We're in. We know there's going to be extra multiverse villains. We know there's going to be other Spider-Men. Nice try deleting the other two from the trailer at the end. Having to point out the absurdity of Otto Octavius's name is the kind of self-awareness that is uninspired and lazy, and just dated, quite frankly.
What was your name again?
Dr. Otto Octavius.
Genius.
Audiences were fine with Otto Octavius's ridiculous name all the way back in 2004.
Four mechanical arms welded right onto his body. Guy named Otto Octavius winds up with 8 limbs. What are the odds?
We don't need any self-referential jokes about it.
Doctor Strange.
That's pretty good. But it's taken.
I'm fine with withholding Tugboat and Garfield in the trailer, but give me just a little bit more to chew on here. This makes me think of all the Eternals trailers, where rather than just show us the characters and reasons why these characters are going to be interesting in their own right, they kept resorting to explaining away Thanos and the snap, and where the Eternals were when all this other MCU shit was going on. It doesn't matter. It didn't matter when they started spinning off these properties in the first place, it doesn't matter now. Either way, my concerns for the redeemed villains like Doc Ock, Sandman, and arguably the Lizard still stand. I hope Willem Dafoe and Jamie Foxx also have a lot of potential with their villains, and I Dafoe in particular.
MJ and I, we're gonna have a hell of a time.
I'm hoping that they're going to be used for not only some good battles, but some good villainy. Let's test Spider-Man, let's ruin his life. I liked Homecoming and Far From Home, but I feel like this movie has way more room for things to go wrong. It has the potential to be amazing or spectacularly bad.
Gonna cry?
There's a lot more room for things to be tainted, for arcs to be ruined, for opportunities to be squandered. It could be an out-and-out disaster. I really don't want everything to culminate in a wet cataclysm of early 2000s entertainment. It doesn't help that in the near future we're going to see Temuera Morrison back, Hayden Christensen back, Ewan McGregor back. It's like someone's trying to get us to party like it's 2002. I think that Warner Brothers are going to handle the return of Neo and Bat Keaton much better than all this Marvel stuff, but we'll see.
You gotta fight for it.
We don't want anyone to get hurt.
In terms of a complete package, I think there's a lot to like about Tom Holland's Spider-Man, and I've detailed that in some previous videos. Even though there's been a lot of awful stuff, I think the genuinely good moments have balanced out the bad. But there is one thing about the MCU Spider-Man that has always bothered me, and it shows no signs of letting up this trend in No Way Home, and that is Spider-Man's numerous crimes to fashion. Some superheroes have a long-storied history of being fashionistas in the comic books. The X-Men all have more than one iconic outfit each. Batman flip-flops between more cloth-based outfits and tech-infused stuff, and the fans seem to go for both. Some have become ridiculed, and others have become just as iconic as the original costumes. But Spider-Man is different. Sure, Spider-Man has had tons of outfits on the comic book page over the years. But much like Superman, none of these outfits have ever come close to touching the same iconic status as the original red and blue. There's been a few contextual outfits like the Black Symbiote suit or the Iron Spider in the Civil War days, but these are few and far between. And he's not really a character that warrants a whole bunch of redesigns. The whole point of Spider-Man is that he's always broke and repairing his costume himself, and he hasn't got enough money to go out and buy all these different extra bells and whistles. He's often in a rush and mending the same tattered costume. The red and blue look being pretty much a constant over Spider-Man's over 70 year history, it's just as important as Iron Man cycling through a load of different iterations of the Iron Man suit. Not every superhero needs a bazillion costumes. It depends on what suits that character.
Jarvis, you there?
At your service, sir.
Superhero movies were once less concerned with dishing out so many costumes. In the case of something like X-Men in the early 2000s, they really didn't want to rock the boat. We're sticking with black leather, guys. This works. We're good. Sam Raimi's Spider-Man kept the same outfit across all three movies, with only some minor touch-ups here and there in the sequels that you wouldn't notice without a keen eye. If there's any changes to the Fantastic Four's outfits, then they must be subtle, because I cannot tell, nor do I care to look hard enough. Christopher Nolan's Batman would have had just one suit if the director had had more prep time for Batman Begins. The Begins suit was designed closer in line to the original costumes, where the Dark Knight was unable to turn its head. When it came to the sequel, Nolan had far more free rein to design something completely different to what had come before. The segmented armoured look would have probably been there from the start and lasted through to the final film. I think both suits are cool in their own way. The Begins suit makes him look beefier and more of a brawler, but the more slimming armoured fit suits much better with the world Nolan had crafted. Now, just because these series had little to no alternate costumes doesn't make them inherently good or make the designs automatically awesome, but it is a clear signifier of how superhero movies have become more in tune with their commercial viability. As Nolan noted in a recent interview, they have become engines of commerce, and I think that is nowhere more obvious than in the MCU and how it absolutely bulldozes through outfits. In the very first MCU flick, there are three costumes for our main superhero, but of course that makes perfect sense for Iron Man, especially an origin story.
Yeah, I can fly.
The evolution of the costumes in that movie are directly tied to the hero's journey. As Tony tinkers with the suits, they come closer to the red and gold visage that we know and love. Iron Man 2 got another three suits, but much like the entire film itself, the script had a flimsy reason for each of them to be there. The Mark IV was a simple redesign of the Mark III, the suitcase armour was pretty much good for one action sequence, and the Mark VI saw a circle form into a triangle. Ooh. Before you swarm me in the comments, the suitcase armour is awesome, it's a fantastic sequence, it's one of the best suit ups of the Iron Man tenure. The first movie represents a clear evolution for each stage of the costuming. In Iron Man 2, these appearances are more gimmicky. From there on out, as standard, Tony would go on to get at least three suits of every appearance, and this would go on until Civil War, Infinity War and Endgame, where he got one new suit each time. Iron Man is one thing, but not every single character in the MCU needs a redesign with each progressive installment, let alone multiple outfits per movie. Whether it's Thor or Black Widow, the MCU is always redesigning its outfits, sometimes in subtle ways, a la the 2000 superhero movies, but other times in huge drastic ways. Seldom do they actually have an impact on the story. Again, a lot of costumes doesn't necessarily mean they're bad, and just having a few costumes doesn't mean they're inherently good. It's just that it's become so obvious now that there is a mandate to keep redesigning Spider-Man's outfits and chuck several more new ones into each new movie, just so that you can sell toys. And hype based on nothing more than intertextuality. Hey look, Iron Man's gonna get his armor based on the Ultimate line of comics. Oh, Cap finally got the scales. Thor now has black chainmail. Woo. And that's what brings us to Spider-Man, because no one needs multiple outfits less than old webhead. In the earliest days of the MCU, Parker had a homemade suit and a Stark-made suit that was the MCU's attempt at the classic Spider-Man costume. Of course, it can't look too identical to the one that came before, or audiences might sniff out the fact that this is the third reboot in 6 years, so no raised webbing, let's give him some black stripes here and there. Why? Well, because why not? Actually, these lenses are incredible and I'm glad to see other Spidey media adopt it. Homecoming shows restraint by keeping Peter in these two outfits, but then make way for the Iron Spider. The Iron Spider is, I'm sorry, it's ugly as fuck. The CGI on it never looks right, no doubt because they're trying to go for an agile, skin-type costume that also behaves like an Iron Man armor. These gauntlets are cumbersome and the colours have always been off. But for the two-part space adventure that is Infinity War and Endgame, it makes sense. I don't mind Spidey getting a new outfit for a one-off, especially when it takes him out of his comfort zone, like space. It would have been kind of cool to me to see Spider-Man fighting Thanos looking like Spider-Man rather than Iron Man, but sure. The problem comes with Spider-Man Far From Home. This is also where the remarks about Iron Boy Jr. reached a fever pitch amongst the fanbase. I would wager that the Iron Spider outfit definitely had something to do with this. He continues to wear it as a friendly neighborhood crime fighter, making full use of the spider arms and extra bells and whistles. And it just feels so wrong. Seeing him repeatedly de-nanotech his face mask is a cool novelty when he's in outer space with Tony Stark, but it's weird when he's in New York talking to Aunt May. I want to see Peter making his own suits, not clinging to the hand-me-downs. The Iron Spider's overlong tenure feels like a direct response to the plot hole era of film fandom. It feels like it's only stuck around for so long, because otherwise there would be 10 different Screen Rant articles asking why Peter didn't keep it when it's clearly the most powerful suit Peter has ever had access to. I don't think anybody would really care if he threw this suit away with no explanation after Endgame. It's a special one-off suit. Spider-Man always goes back to his iconic red and blues in the comics. So there's the Iron Spider suit, and then we see him briefly back in the Civil War Homecoming look before getting a completely new, stupid fucking costume. The Night Monkey is a weird ode to Spider-Man Noir without any of the context that makes that look interesting. And again, this suit's whole reason to exist feels like a way to paper over internet criticism. He only wears it so that the general public won't cotton on to the fact that he has come along on a field trip with Peter Parker's class. This suit is meant to distract from suspicion, even though it still clearly looks like a Spider-Man suit and Peter swings around in open view. He then also dons a full Spidey look in London, completely throwing the pretense that this suit was needed out of the window. I can imagine the clickbait had Peter fought crime in Europe looking like regular Spider-Man. The unforgivable Spider-Man Far From Home mistake. What Far From Home did that made absolutely no sense, and so on. And I have to say, who gives a fuck? Spider-Man has gone to different countries in the comics, he did it in the cartoons, it's about as hokey as no one questioning why Clark Kent looks like Superman. Secret identities have never made a lick of sense, and we love them anyway. The only suit transition that makes sense is the upgrade suit. It's the first suit in the MCU, aside from the starter pajamas, that feels like Peter's own. He makes it using his own incredible mind, and he has access to this incredible tech not because Stark gave him a handout, but because he proved he knew how to use it when he was a dumpster diver. So this to me feels earned. It's not a SHIELD uniform, or an Iron Man suit, or something that was designed without his say-so. This is what Peter chooses to save people wearing, and it rocks. As far as I'm concerned, this is the suit we should stick to for a good while. But No Way Home shows no signs of slowing down the costume roulette. Not only does it appear that the upgrade suit and Iron Spider are both making a return, but we've got his black and gold suit, and this suit, which is a variation of the upgrade suit, I believe it's called the integrated suit. That's four costumes already, that we know of, just based on the marketing material. And yeah, maybe each costume will have an utterly unique, story-centric reason to be in the movie, but this ain't Iron Man. Spider-Man only really needs one suit for most occasions. I did initially think the Iron Spider was a placeholder for another outfit in the trailer, but since it's been on the official poster and a bunch of other images, I think it's safe to say this is going to pop up for a decent amount of screen time yet again. I just have to ponder, why? Especially after he ditched it for the upgrade suit. The reasons for each suit range from interesting to nonsensical. A fair few people have pointed out that it looks like the Iron Spider suit is being stripped from Peter and attaching to the Ock arms. Thank God that's the reason they're red and he isn't a variant of the Spider-Man 2 version, or God forbid Tony Stark had some sort of involvement. I hope this is Otto's doing and he's getting an upgrade rather than Peter doing it to trap the villain. As much as I'm hyped about seeing the Iron Spider suit destroyed, he shouldn't be wearing it in the first place. He's moved on. Supposedly the black and gold suit is going to be his main suit turned inside out. This seems to check out in the trailer. You can see some exposed wiring and the like. I imagine he'll probably customise it to fight Electro, but here's the thing, in The Amazing Spider-Man 2, Peter customises the suit to do the very same thing, and he didn't need an entirely different look for it. I can't believe you're making me defend The Amazing Spider-Man 2. In any case, it just reinforces to me how unnecessary it is to give Peter loads of different outfits. There's nothing interesting about the trailer, Peter's desire to keep the villains alive, the possible deaths, that would alter by keeping him in one solid look. Does the red and black upgrade suit need any more crap on top of it? Does it really need all this gold? It just seems like overkill. The upgrade suit is nicely composed, but this gold layer makes it too busy, much like the Iron Spider. I think Tobey and Andrew's suits are going to upstage all of Tom's, not just because they'll be wearing them for the first time in many years, but because those costumes are synonymous with the brightest memories of their runs for their respective fans. Both costumes are unique to those eras, and will forever be inseparable from those portrayals. At this point, the PS4 Spider-Man has a more definitive look than Tom Holland's on-screen iteration. It's not like the 2000s superhero movies didn't also sell a bunch of action figures. Remember the scene in Batman Begins with these costumes? But now new costumes are so frequent and often so visually busy that they lose their prominence. They feel like calculated marketing moves rather than the evolution of the character's story. Pairing a modern day Spider-Man up with the ones of yesteryear only makes that even more readily apparent. Overall, I have high hopes for the future of Spider-Man, but I want to see this movie give Peter lasting pain. I want to see him take on more small-scale human problems in the next trilogy that highlight the more down-to-earth aspects of his stories, rather than the big multiverse-ending apocalypses. I want to see less of a concern on his aesthetics and gadgets, and more of a reason to care. Into the Spider-Verse is going to be tough to beat as the Spider-Man Christmas movie, but we'll know soon enough. A big thank you to my full fat tier patrons, Dr. Chike and Craig Hurst. If you want to find me on Instagram, you can find me at full_fat_videos. And if you want to find me on Twitter, that's at fullfatvideos. Until next time, do something with milk, I guess.